Billy Graham is a real puzzle to me. In 1948, he said, the evangelical church faces three major enemies: communism, Catholicism, and Mohammedanism. By that he meant Islam. By 1952, he had turned around completely, was saying that his beliefs were basically the same as those of Orthodox Roman Catholics. Any converts going forward in a Billy Graham crusade, Catholics are sent back to the Catholic Church, thousands, tens of thousands. I have files with Bishop so-and-so from this city, Bishop so-and-so from that city, in newspapers saying the greatest thing that could happen is a Billy Graham crusade. That's how we get all the lapsed Catholics back into the church, saying that Billy Graham would never say anything against the church, the Catholic Church. Billy Graham received an honorary doctorate, for example, from Belmont Abbey, Belmont College, which was a Jesuit school. And in the acceptance speech, he said, the gospel that built this school and the gospel that I preach are one and the same. Billy Graham has met with the Pope five times, at my last count. He has had in-depth, by his own confession, in his autobiography, for example, he's had in-depth discussions in the Vatican with their theologians. He spent a week in the Vatican on one occasion. He's had in-depth discussions with the Pope. And yet he says on the Larry King Live program, for example, and on other occasions, Billy Graham said, the Pope and I agree on almost everything, and any differences we have are not important theologically. Billy Graham is a great friend of the Roman Catholic Church. He praises, for example, the nearest thing to a televangelist that the Catholic Church ever had was Archbishop Fulton J. Sheen. And his videos are still, you know, he's dead now, but his videos are still in circulation. And you will find in the ads in major magazines, newspapers, there's an endorsement by Billy Graham, who calls Fulton Sheen, he says, the greatest communicator of this century. Well, he was a great communicator, but of a false gospel. Billy Graham has called the Pope the greatest religious leader of the century. On Larry King Live, for example, Larry King said, Billy, how do you feel about other, and he's struggling for the term denominations or churches, what he didn't quite come out with. He says, like the Mormons and the Catholics. Billy Graham said, oh, I think I have a wonderful fellowship with all of them. And Larry King says, you have no problem with Salt Lake City, with the Vatican? Billy says, oh, the Pope and I are the best of friends. In fact, when he was made Pope in Rome, I was preaching in his cathedral at Krakow, Poland. In fact, on that occasion, Billy was preaching and had preached in four Catholic cathedrals in Poland. Now, you know that he's not saying anything that would upset the Catholics, or they're not going to have him there. He went to Jasna Góra because this is the Black Virgin, the protectress of Poland, which was the favorite of the Pope, and he greeted the pilgrims there and complimented them, you know, and what a wonderful thing it was, and so forth. Billy went on the Larry King Live program. He said, in fact, when the Pope came to South Carolina, he invited me to be on the platform with him. He would give one talk and I would give the other. But I was halfway to China, Billy said. And then Larry King said, well, what about Judaism? And Billy says, oh, I mean, I've been up to the rabbinical council. You know, we have our friendly discussions. And Rabbi Tannenbaum, who is a good friend of all of us, I relied on him spiritually, theologically, for his counsel in every way. You can imagine the Apostle Paul. They say, how do you get along with the rabbis? Oh, fine. I go up to Sanhedrin. They have me all the time. And Rabbi Gamaliel, I mean, I rely on him theologically, spiritually, in every way. And it gets a little bit worse. But finally, Larry King said, Billy, it's halftime at the Super Bowl. You got 30 seconds. What would you say? Greatest opportunity he ever had to preach the gospel. And I'm not denying Billy preaches the gospel. On some occasions he does, but he also compromises. Billy said, I would tell them to think about another game, the game of life, and to be sure they're on God's side. And he will answer their prayers if they will make that commitment to him. No cross, no Christ, no gospel, no salvation. Billy Graham, of course, was the first evangelical to accept the Templeton Award for progress in religion. John Marks Templeton is one of the most clever anti-Christians. He's an occultist, science of mind, and so forth. He's a very wealthy Wall Street money manager. But he believes you're God, I'm God, everything is God. The Bible is not the word of God. All religions are equally valid, but they're all equally wrong. And what we need is a new religion is scientific, that would be acceptable to all religions on this earth and to all extraterrestrials out there as well, and is not dependent upon ancient manuscripts like the Bible, although he was 15 years on the board of managers of the American Bible Society. He had two terms, 6 years as chairman of the board of the Princeton Theological Seminary, and the man does not believe the Bible. You create your own reality with your mind. Heaven and hell are in your mind. You make your own heaven and your own hell. This man is as bad as you can get. And now what he's working for is the new world religion, obviously, of the Antichrist. And he says, to encourage progress toward the establishment of this religion, I have founded the Templeton Award for Progress in Religion. You couldn't possibly accept that. No evangelical could accept that. We don't believe that Christianity, for example, is a religion. Furthermore, it doesn't change. You don't make progress in Christianity. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The truth doesn't change. Billy Graham accepted the award. You read of it in his autobiography, and he's just so pleased and thrilled. Charles Colson accepted the award. Charles Colson gave his acceptance speech at the 1993 Parliament of the World Religions in Chicago, and on the platform behind him when he gave his acceptance speech were monks and Buddhists and Hindu and Muslim, and he didn't give them the gospel. It was all sort of religiously correct terminology about spiritual awakening and moral values and this kind of stuff. That service was opened by a Muslim chant and closed by a Buddhist prayer. And this is where Charles Colson gave his acceptance speech, all right? And he praised John Templeton and this award. Bill Bright accepted the award at a Catholic church in Rome. His opening words in his acceptance speech were, Your Eminence, Cardinal Cassidy. Cardinal Cassidy is the leader of the ecumenical movement out of Rome. He is the Pope's ambassador, travels around the world. He is actually the man behind ECT 1 and 2. Every word had to be approved by the Pope through Cardinal Cassidy, okay? He's the man that put this thing together. And Bill Bright's opening words are, Your Eminence, Cardinal Cassidy. So pleased that he was there. In his acceptance speech, Bill Bright praised John Marks Templeton. What a great man he was, and praised his prize, this award, as the greatest award that could possibly be given. This is what he had to say about an award for forming the Antichrist world religion. So this is how the ecumenism and compromise has come into the evangelical church. But of course, many of the recipients of the Templeton Award were Catholics. Mother Teresa, as I mentioned, and so forth. Billy Graham, it's not too hard, maybe, to understand something about him. Billy Graham, for example, has accepted theistic evolution. He says he sees no problem with God having used evolution. Well, there are some problems. The Pope, of course, accepts it. The Catholic Church accepts theistic evolution. So does Promise Keepers. So has Christianity Today in an editorial. They agreed with the Pope. A basic problem, just real fast with that, is if I can't accept what the Bible says about the origin of man, why should I accept Billy Graham's gospel about the destiny of man? If I can't accept what it says about the man's fall and separation from God, why should I accept what it says about his reconciliation? Adam is mentioned about 30 times in 10 books of the Bible. If you pull Adam out, you puncture so many holes in the Bible, it can't contain truth. Jesus is called the last Adam. His genealogy is traced back to Adam. Furthermore, Jesus believed in Adam and Eve. He said, for this cause, a man will leave father and mother, and he talked about in the Bible, the Genesis account. He's not God if the Genesis account is wrong. The Bible says, by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men for all have sinned. But if these critters have been evolving and dying, if they were what Cardinal O'Connor recently said, a couple of anthropoid critters that God zapped with a human soul, then death was in this world before sin. And the Bible is wrong on that account also. The Bible says that God created Adam first, and he was here for quite a while, and he named the animals and so forth. God saw that he needed a helpmeet, and he put him to sleep, and out of a rib he created a woman. You can't reconcile that with two critters evolving side by side, male and female, and then he zaps them, and here they are. So then Billy Graham has said he's not sure the flood was worldwide. Well, the Bible very clearly says everything died, everything that breathed died, all the mountains were covered. There's no doubt about what the Bible says about it. And, of course, you've never seen a rainbow because the rainbow was only a promise that that local flood wouldn't happen again, so you got to go over to Mesopotamia where the rainbow appears if you want to see a rainbow. And furthermore, we don't have to worry about the world being destroyed by fire because it's likened to the flood. So if it was a local flood, it's a local fire. Billy Graham recently on Larry King Live, Larry King, who's married to a Mormon, so he believes in eternal marriage. I mean, his wife does. I don't know what Larry King believes in. But Larry King, of course, being interested in the subject, asked Billy Graham if there was sex in heaven. And Billy said, well, if it's essential to our happiness, there will be. Well, it's very clear. The Bible, Jesus says, we're like the angels. We're neither married nor given in marriage. So if there's sex in heaven, it's got to be extramarital sex.